everyone. See if you can see me. My name is Vanessa, and I'm the Event and Communications Coordinator here at Care Indeed. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm pleased to welcome Melissa Vasquez for today's webinar on common blind spots, helping the blind. Melissa graduated cum laude from St. Mary's with a Bachelor of Science in Adolescent and Adult Psychology. She then attended San Jose State University, and she earned her master's in social work with honors. She has been sober for 20 years, and during that time, she helped teach addiction to Stanford medical students. Melissa worked in social work for 16 years in the areas of sexual assault and domestic violence. And additionally, Melissa was born with the eye disease retinitis pigmentosa, from which she will eventually go blind unless there is a cure soon. She was diagnosed at the age of 6 months, and she has been legally blind since 22. In her visually impaired life, Melissa has unfortunately and shamefully run into every level of discrimination from every kind of person, including those of all ages, races, education, even medical, socioeconomic status, gender, sexual orientation, and so on. So with today's presentation, Melissa hopes that she will help individuals better understand, sympathize with, and support the blind. So again, thank you everyone for joining us today. I will go ahead and pass it over to Melissa.
Thanks, Vanessa. Hi, everybody. Thanks for being open and wanting to learn more about the blind community. The first slide and the front slide that I wanted to show you guys, is it being shown? Sorry. There's a picture. The first slide shows a picture, and I wanted everyone to understand that everyone's born with, if you see that little, there's a little black spot on the left of the central vision that everyone's born with. It's actually because of the optic nerve, and your brain fills it in. So that kind of explains certain retinal diseases like mine, retinitis pigmentosa, where I think I can see way more than I actually can because my brain fills it in. So that's just something that I wanted to know. We all have blind spots, I guess, in general. We are born with it. And also in the community, people need to learn more. And there's a lot of ignorance when it comes to the blind community. And I hope this will teach you to empathize and to better help us to feel normal and live in the world. So next slide, please. So I wanted to go over how common disabilities are in the United States. There's about 49 million. So that makes up about 1 out of 5. It's pretty surprising. So, and a lot of them are invisible that you can't see. So everyone assumes you can tell if someone's disabled, but that's not always the case. And visual disability makes up one of the top 10 disabilities in the United States. And another reason I think this is crucial for people to learn if you're caring for somebody, in 35 years in the United States, visual impairment will double, and in the world, it will triple, which probably because, you know, the US, we're aging, the aging population makes up the majority. And also just in the world, visual impairment's gonna become more common. You'll have someone in your family or friends most likely. So next slide, please. So what is blindness? Most people assume that someone who's blind only sees total blackness, which is not the case. There's less than 10% of the blind that actually see nothing. Blindness is a spectrum. And even some people like me that I'm slowly going blind over time, once I'm totally blind, I might still see flashes or even movement, things like that. And the other thing I wanted to highlight is visual impairment, of course, is if you become visually impaired to the point you can't work or read or cook, but it's not something that can be fixed with glasses. We hear a lot in the community, oh, well, I'm blind without my glasses. That's actually not true. I do wear glasses, but I still am legally blind. And I'll go over what legally blind means in further slides. Next slide, please, thanks. So one thing my blind friends who went over this month with me wanted people to understand that there's 4 different ways the blind identifies themselves. And there's not like a all of us kind of want to be referred differently. So some people say they're partially sighted, which is kind of self-explanatory. They see parts of things, like me. It's like looking through Swiss cheese for me, actually. When someone says low vision, that usually means they're severely visually impaired, where they see 20/70 on the visual acuity chart. And I'll go over that, what visual acuity is. Legally blind, which is usually how I refer myself, it's where I see 20/200, even with glasses, or worse, or the visual field is 20 degrees or less. And I'll be going over what visual field means. And totally blind is the complete loss of sight. Next slide. So I wanted to go over what is legally blind. So like I said before, it's where you see 20/200 or worse, even with glasses. So if you look at the visual acuity chart on the bottom or on the left, I can only see the big E, even with glasses. And then someone who says they're low vision, it's 20/70, which is the third section down on the visual acuity chart. And then the visual field, this picture seems to allow people to understand much better what we're talking about when we say we're seeing 20 degrees or less or 10 degrees of sight. So visual field is more your peripheral. So if you're looking straight, it's what you see above you, below you, and to the sides. So my diagnosis is I see about 20 degrees, which is like looking through, toilet paper roll. And you can do this, and then that's pretty much what I see. But there are pockets that show up. Every day's different. Sometimes I can see some on the side, sometimes not. Depends on stress and the lighting. Contrast is very important. That's why on these slides, I even changed the color so I could see it better. But eventually, with my disease, I'm probably going to start seeing through a straw like this. It's going to end up like that. But some people, like I have a friend that sees through a straw, which is, I think, 5 degrees of field, but she can see 20/20 and can read the acuity chart. So technically she could drive, but we don't want her to. So I hope this better explains when someone says they're losing their peripheral vision, that's what it means. Next slide, thanks. So these are just some blindness statistics. I didn't put all of them. You can go to the site that I refer to on the bottom if you want more of like gender and race differences. But I wanted to highlight some of the important ones that I think are important. So the total amount of the blind in the US now is a little more than 7.5 million. This was interesting. The educational attainment of high school is 31%. College or associate's degrees is 30%. And a bachelor degrees or higher is 15%. But the median income is about 38,000. And the percentage living under the poverty line is 28%. And a lot of people wonder why we're not working. 70% are not employed because there is discrimination when it comes to being blind, because it does take longer sometimes for us to do things and we do need extra help. Sometimes we need different equipment that's very costly, which I can go into that in the next few slides. And I just wanted to go over generally the anatomy of the eye so you kind of understand some of the eye diseases you'll probably run into. One really good analogy I like to use is the eye is like a camera, and everyone, you know, knows the general makeup of a camera. So there's the lens and the film, and I'll go through that on how that applies to the anatomy of the eye. So the first is the cornea, which is the clear tissue in the very front of the eye. I've had a lot of friends say, oh, there's eye transplants now, which actually is called a corneal transplant, which is where they, you know, they do a transplant of just the front section. But with me, it's the retina that's deteriorating, and I can go, it's not the whole eye. The iris is the colored part. The pupil is the dark part in the middle that allows light to come into your eye. The lens is a small clear disc that helps you focus. And that's, lenses are, they're taken out when someone has cataracts. That's where there's cataract surgeries, where the lens starts getting cloudy. And I'll go into that in the next few slides. the retina, which is hard for people to understand. It's like the film of the camera. That's the best way I can describe it. So it's the layer of the back of the eyes with cells that take light and color. And that's the part in my disease that's deteriorating. And there's no cure because we can't recreate the signal or even the retina to send that signal to the brain. We're still kind of in the dark ages of understanding and being able to fix the brain. The macula is a small central area of the retina that helps you focus. So if someone has macular degeneration, it's actually the central part of their vision. So like reading and things like that, that's very difficult. And that's why a lot of people with macular degeneration don't use a cane, because they can see in the bottom and their peripheral, so they don't feel that they need to use one. And then the optic nerve, where everyone has the blind spot, it connects the eye to the brain and carries the electrical signal of what you're seeing to the brain. And then lastly, the vitreous is the clear jelly-like substance in the middle of the eye. And that's usually when there's floaters. If people say they see little dots or things floating around, it's little things that are in the vitreous of the eye. Next slide. So these are five common diseases. There's several diseases out there, but these are the most common that you'll probably run into. So there's the age-related macular degeneration, which I explained before. It's the macula part of the eye that's degenerating. It's usually age-related, so it tends to be in the elderly, and it makes it hard for them to see sharply and to read and to do any fine details. Cataracts are when the lens of the eye gets cloudy, like I said before, and the pictures on the left kind of show you how someone sees when they have these conditions. And of course, if they go in with the lens with cataract surgery, it can be pretty well fixed with surgery. And then there's diabetic retinopathy, which is someone that has diabetes, and it's the leading cause of blindness in the United States. And it's where the blood vessels of the retina are being damaged. And with diabetic retinopathy, if you go in soon, you know, if you start seeing these little dark areas that are filled in usually, but you'll start not seeing your hand and things like that, things that aren't there. So people recommend is to obviously watch their sugar levels and try to stick to the diabetic diet, but also going into the doctor if someone's seeing changes, to go into the eye doctor. People don't want to go, so the sooner the better. Next slide. The last two, one is glaucoma, and this is a group of diseases that can damage the optic nerve. So it's where the fluid pressure in the eye rises, and that's not good. It can get very bad if someone does not go in as soon as possible. There are drops people can take. There are surgeries that can help it, or at least reduce the speed of the degeneration. And then retinal detachment, it's kind of self-explanatory. It's where the retina detaches from the back of the eye. And a lot of times people just don't go in and they think it'll go away or it'll go better. And the longer someone waits, the more likely the vision will not come back with surgery. Next slide. So this is just mobility information that I was even surprised about. A lot of people ask me, you know, why don't I use my cane all the time? Only 2-8% of the blind actually use a cane. And the reasons, I don't think I know all the reasons, but for personally and with my friends, when you go into public, people will stare at you. They will question if you're faking it, because I'm young, you know, and I don't look blind. They'll touch you or come up and try to pray for you. Some will even yell directions if I look lost, which is something I'll go into later that is not actually safe to do. They'll take your cane or they yell obscenities at you. Also, everyone asks, am I going to get a guide dog? Surprisingly, only 2% of the blind actually get a guide dog. And these are the reasons that I think they don't get a guide dog. There's a long waiting list. It's usually in another state, so you have to go for a month and train with the dog. you also have to meet certain qualifications. And also to have the dog, I'm also physically disabled, and you have to be able to work the dog 5 days a week for several hours, or the dog will lose its training. So it could be unsafe if you do not walk them or train them enough. So those, I think, are some of the reasons the blind don't get a dog. Next slide, thank you. And then I get the question, why haven't I learned Braille? So Braille is only taught in certain schools. Around here in Fremont, there is a school for the blind. Usually it's kids that are born blind or severely visually impaired. And I didn't become legally blind until I was 22. So I went to regular schools and was, quote, normal. I did have night blindness, but that's something else. But at blind centers, even around here that are in the resources, they only teach the alphabet for free. Also, there aren't very many books anymore. I think due to technology, a lot of people, you know, things are read to them. And then Braille equipment. So I was able to get some equipment in grad school through the Department of Rehab, but it was if I was going to get a job. That's one of the only ways you can get this stuff. And also they don't, you know, things every year, there's new advancements in the technology and they don't provide that. And to get it yourself, it is extremely expensive to get a printer or a computer that's Braille in Braille. So next slide, please. So here's a really good picture on how to guide a blind person. I wish this was taught in more places. So the woman on the right has, who's blind, is in the blue. And then the one on the left with the white shirt is the person that's guiding her. So things to what, you know, to keep in mind is, of course, when you go up to a blind person, announce that you're there and who you are, because we can't see you coming. Also, if you can notice she's grabbing, you know, right above the elbow, and her arm is close to her body. So then the blind person can feel if the person that can see is going left or right or up and down stairs. And also, as you can tell, she's about a step behind her, because that gives them time to be able to adjust if there is a step or, you know, if you have to go left or right. A lot of people want me to guide them or have the blind person guide, and that's probably not the safest thing to do. So I'll just go over what not to do on the bottom. Of course, just don't go up and grab them. I've said that. Don't have us guide you guys. Don't grab them by the clothes, the belt loops, the back of the neck. These are actual examples that have happened. And don't just yell directions at them, because that's going to make them even more scared to really know, does that person know, you know, which way I need to go or what's in front of me. So next slide. So this is how to approach someone who's blind that's in distress. I've had some of my friends ask me, you know, they saw a blind person, you know, having issues, how should they have handled it? So the first is if they have a guide dog and they have their harness on, they're working. Don't distract the dog by petting it or giving it food, because it's doing a job and trying to keep the blind person safe. And if the dog gets distracted, then the blind person is in danger. And if they are in distress and you go up to them and say, hey, I'm here, I can help you, can I guide you? But if they don't want your help, don't force it upon them. And like I said, don't just yell directions, especially I've heard stories where, you know, people are in their car and they see a blind person, not sure whether they should cross the street, and they start yelling directions. And I have heard it's become lethal for some of the blind people, because the person in the car doesn't always see like a bicyclist coming or someone turning left or right. We're actually in cane training. We're trained to hear the traffic and to know when to go. And also like in a store or in a hospital or caretaking situation, if someone with a cane comes up, don't just point, you know, go to number three, or it's down this aisle, or it's to the left or right, we're not going to be able to find it. So I know it's a little extra work for you guys, but it would mean a lot if you could just guide them to where or what they're trying to find. Next slide, please. And I have a lot of my friends ask me, what should I say or not say to a visually impaired person? So like I said before, ask them how they want to be identified. Like my friend Travis, he wants to be called blind, even though he can see shapes and movements. I usually say legally blind. Some of my other friends say low vision. So it's whatever they want to be identified as. And if they have a medical issue that they tell you about, it would mean a lot if you just, there's YouTube videos, there's a lot of information out there that you could understand their visual impairment without them having to explain it over and over every day. It gets very exhausting. And also just ask them, how can I best help you? What is the best way? What can you see today? Because my vision changes daily. So if someone just says, hey, how's your vision today? And I let them know what would really help me, that would mean a lot. And here are things not to say to someone who says they're visually impaired but don't look visually impaired. Like, I don't know if you can see this, but, you know, look at this. Or, oh, you saw that? You must be faking it. I can't tell you how many times people have said I'm faking it. Or you don't look blind, you're too young, your eyes are too pretty, you know, things like that. Also, if they say they can't see something, don't continue to point to it and try to force them to fake that they're seeing it. And also don't laugh at them, because we get laughed at a lot since we don't look blind. Next slide. And here's just more things to be mindful of if you're caring for someone with a visual impairment. The main thing is if, like, you're in their home or wherever their environment is, if you move something, let them know that you moved it and where you put it, or if anything, don't move anything, because I've learned the more I've gone blind, I have to have everything where I left it or in a certain spot, or it'll take me hours to find it. Or if you move furniture or you put things on the floor, let them know, because they're used to their, you know, I'm very comfortable in my home because I know where everything is. But if things change, I'll probably run into it and fall. Also, when leaving or entering a room, let them know, because they can't always hear if you, you know, enter or leave. So sometimes we'll be talking and then the person's not there. Also, depending on where the visually impaired person is on the grief cycle, because losing your vision or suddenly losing it, you go through the grief cycle. Some of my friends go, oh, I'll see you later. Oops, sorry. And to me, it doesn't bother me. It's just a phrase that's commonly used. But there are some people that are blind or going blind that would offend them. So if that happens, just try to keep that in mind, that they're still in the anger phase of what's going on with them, which is okay. But you do get out of it over time. Okay, next slide. So here are common misconceptions. I'm not going to read all of them, but I'll just go through some of the ones that stand out. There was a study done that the population believes that going blind or losing your sight is actually worse than having AIDS, cancer, Alzheimer's disease, losing a limb, hearing, and all that. So I think the fear around it is what causes a lot of the ignorance. And here are some examples that has happened to myself or some of my friends in the community. So most can't believe that there's not a cure. They assume if it's in the movies, like Minority Report, that there's eye transplants and that we're more advanced than we are in the medical field. And some will, like I said, laugh. And say things, you're too young, or you're looking straight at my face, or you saw a car move, or I'm looking at my phone. That's a big thing, is we can actually, I blow up the font in my phone to as big as it can. And also there are ways we can get through the phone with voiceover that it will talk to us. They play tricks sometimes to test you if you're really blind, like hold up fingers, how many fingers am I holding up? They'll wave in front of us to see if we see their hands. I had at work or at my internship, someone pointing a laser to try to see if I could see it. Stuff like that is, to me, very disrespectful of not believing me. And it's something, if they tell you, it's hard enough to tell people that you have an issue and that you're struggling. And having populations tested is really hard to even ask for help. Let's see. One of my friends went to a post office and some of the workers were making bets on whether she's blind or not, like financial money bets, and were making fun of her, thinking she couldn't hear them. Some even like at my job now, a lawyer completely ignored my existence or that I was even there. And also some will come up and just touch me and pray for me and say that if I had enough faith that I would have been healed already. So yeah, next slide. So here's a letter that I'll read. I'll do the best I can. But this is the message that I'm trying to get out to educate more. And please send this out to anybody that you feel that will help them. So I am a woman. I am a daughter. I am a sister. I am a mother. I am a social worker. I am an advocate. I am blind. I am many things, not only blind. My blindness has shaped me, but it does not define me. People tell me I must be so strong and brave. Here's what people need. What people need to understand. Living with a visual or with a disability is not strength. A disability is not a choice. But they are right, I am strong. I am strong because true strength is choosing happiness when you have so much to be unhappy about. You're right, I am brave. But it's not because I continue living. I am brave because I continue in spite of the fear. My disability is not what causes my fear. It's people's ignorance and my fear of injury, the fear of how they will treat me and how they react to me. I live in a world designed for them. They acknowledge their apprehension and fear of us living with blindness. Yet many do nothing to make life easier for those of us who are living with it. Many criticize, many demean, many spread ignorance. No one would choose this life. That does not mean we cannot find acceptance, peace, and happiness within it. However, to pretend that even the most well-adjusted of us does not face struggles, anxiety, depression, and fear would be false. So I ask you to please try to be more understanding and empathetic. Try to remember that every day we are struggling. Try to remember that just because we are happy doesn't mean things are easy. And most importantly, try to remember that we are entitled to express our feelings and our needs. Our feelings and need for help are not a burden, even though many of us feel this way. We love and appreciate those that help. There are some, sadly few, extraordinarily amazing sighted people in the world that go out of their way to help us. To those of you who help build, not only for yourself, but for others as well, I thank you. So I ask you to take a moment and think how you would want to be treated, or a family member of yours, what needs to be changed. The world is not meeting the blind's needs, so please help me educate the world so the blind will not fear the sighted and will feel accepted going out into the world. Next slide. So this is a poet named Dave Steele who lives in England, and he's written 3 poetry books. He also has retinitis pigmentosa. And if you know anyone who's lost their sight or is going blind, his poems are very powerful. And it really makes us not feel so alone that there are others out there that feel the way we feel. And if you don't mind, Vanessa, to read the poem, because I struggle. So.
Yes, of course.
Thanks.
So, my blind secrets. I have a secret from the world that most of you don't know. Won't hear it in the way I talk, and eyes no clue will show. If you listen to my story, something new to learn, you'll find. For though I'm looking straight at you, I'm legally blind. It's not a simple yes or no. I'm more a shade of gray. I rarely venture out alone as things get in the way. For what I see affects my days in much more ways than one. And for this, some continues until little left has gone. But this still paints invisible to those that pass us by. There's some afraid to hold a cane because of questions why. Accused of making up our claim and made to feel a fraud, feel drained of all my confidence, feel trapped behind this door. Now, hardest thing to come to terms that makes my days feel long. It holds us back, knowledge they lack for all who've got it wrong. To hear their judge and jury, even though their facts aren't straight, feel misdirected fury. Wish opinions now could wait to take time to get to know the visions that we share. Come join me in my tunnel, hold my hand and show you care.
And then I've left resources in the next few slides of the blind communities. So I found a few YouTube videos that shows the first two are that blindness is a spectrum. And it goes through some of the, I don't want to say more famous, but of the blind community. And they describe all their diseases and how they see. And also on the next section, I put these two videos just as an example. If you run into someone and you can go on YouTube, and these two videos really show my disease. It's not perfect because we all actually have different symptoms and go blind at different rates. But this really helps. Like I've showed my caregivers, because I've had Care Indeed help me as well, and also family and friends. I'll send these two videos. They're both combined less than 10 minutes, but it really shows how I see. And I think education is really key in being able to help someone. So next slide. Here are the resources for the blind. There are just a few, but they're very good, and they can connect people with things to help them cook, get around the house, get trained, support groups. There's even different kind of crafts, like they do painting and sewing. So anytime you run into someone or have a friend, give out this information to them so that they can get more help, and so they don't just stay at home and feel trapped. And the one agency for pretty much just the elderly is called SALA, and they do all these different things I've listed. It's primarily legal, but I have run into my work a lot of the elderly APS reports and things like that. But the next few pages is just domestic violence agencies in general that you can send anybody. And most of them have most languages taken care of, I think. So you can just read through it, or just keep it, or send it to people that you feel are being, even neglect is a type of abuse. So, and there's many different kinds that you'll probably run into. So, yeah, there's Maitri, Community Solutions. They're all very good. They have hotlines, 24-hour hotlines, shelters, support groups. So they're all very good agencies that can help. YWCA, Next Door Solutions. I put some hotlines, the Crime Resource Center of California. So yeah, I think any of those would be good. So thank you everyone for listening and being open to learning.